This is Grace Notes. I'm Alan Button, and pleased to have as our guest today, Anya Kiser. Anya, welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. I'm really excited to be here.
Tell you what, Anya, let's start maybe with a little admission on my part that we got connected because you actually were a server at dinner for me and my wife a couple of weeks ago. And for some reason, you remembered when we called you. Have I got that right?
Yes, of course. Because, you know, I don't get a lot of customers that ask me a lot about me. I'll have a few that will ask, like, where I'm from just because of my name, but not a lot of customers ask about my background and why I'm here. And then also having somebody that has a knows a member who came from Ukraine. So it's kind of one of those memorable things where you just remember. And plus, y'all were so sweet. It was sweetness. Hard to forget.
We have you here because you were so sweet.
Thank you.
For the benefit of our listeners, Anya, as a second job, works waiting tables at TAP 1918 in Rocky Mount. At the new Rocky Mount Mills development, relatively new anyway, and we discovered in being served by Anya that she actually started her life in Ukraine. And yeah, I mentioned that my sister-in-law is from Ukraine. So anyway, with that as background, let me have you say something, Anya, if you would, about what your philosophy of customer service is. What is it that motivates you when you're serving people?
One of the main things that motivates me when I'm serving is that idea of being that one person that can make a difference in someone's life just by smiling. I have found that the effect of smiling can turn a whole day around. And I never know the story of the person that comes into our restaurant. However, I know that I can provide them with a smile, with a warm greeting, and with just good service. And hopefully that can give them something to be happy about and something to make their day just a little bit brighter, especially when everybody's going through the rough times. It's just, it never hurts to smile for someone.
Well, that fits right in with what we say Grace Notes is about. Grace Notes is about those who brighten the lives of others, who make a positive difference in the everyday lives of other people. People, our guests, are usually those whose names are not household names, but like Grace Notes in music scores, brighten the lives of those around them.
Such a beautiful comparison.
I assume that you have experienced the impact of others' smiles and caring attitude in your own life.
I have. You know, as everybody goes through difficult times, for me personally, especially lately, I work in an office where I'm mainly by myself. I get to see my four other coworkers a couple of times a day, but for the most part, I'm to myself, and the when I see other people smile, it makes me want to smile.
And I might interrupt if I could and just say that your day job, your full-time regular job, is as doing accounting work and as office manager for a financial investment firm.
Yes. Small company with very few employees. I make their fifth employee, so it's quite small, and they are quite older generation, so I'm one of their youngest employees at the office. So I don't get a lot of interaction with the outside world. Even after work life, I just don't interact with others. And so when I do get a chance to see somebody, it just makes a world of a difference when they greet me warmly, they smile, and then they ask about me. It just makes me feel seen and heard, and I just feel like if I feel this way, how does it impact others? What if I do the same thing for others and I can pass it along and then they can pass it along? It just makes a chain effect of that. So that's how I go about it.
And you realize that others often feel or may well feel the same kind of things that you're talking about.
I think they do. I feel like not a lot of people talk about it, though. It's hard to just randomly say, I feel alone or I'm lonely. I don't have anyone to talk to. So it's hard to say those things. But just knowing that's how you feel, there's a big chance that somebody else might feel that way. And even if it doesn't impact the whole world, if you can impact one person, I feel like that's worth the effort to do something, even if it's for one person.
I often think of the line that we don't know what goes on behind closed doors.
Yes.
And life is tough. And I think you're on the right track for sure when you assume that others are having challenging times and that you can make a difference.
I think it's also, it's one of those things that it doesn't cost anything to smile for a person. And, you know, just the love and the light that shines through a smile can be so much more impactful than anything that you can say to a person.
I know in our case, too, it was your willingness to take some time and open up and tell us a little bit about yourself. That really can make a difference in others' lives, too.
It's one of those things where I have a story, and if I can share it with others, if I can bring awareness to the ability to choose to be happy, even though you come from a history where it's not all sunshine and rainbows, I think it's really important, because we can choose to smile or we can choose to be sad, and whatever we choose, we're going to pass it on to the people around us. And I just, even through my harder background history, my loneliness of the childhood and so, I still choose to smile because I realize that that's the most important thing that can help others heal. Laughter and smiling and just being kind to others, because that can make a difference.
We'll come back to your history here shortly, and I think actually that's a great segue into this first song that you've selected, If I Can Dream by Elvis Presley. Why that song?
I think it's important to have a dream, and no matter what age it is, and if you dream it and you believe it, you will achieve it.
Let's hear it, If I Can Dream by Elvis Presley.
There must be lights burning brighter somewhere. Got to be.
That was Elvis Presley with If I Can Dream. If you're just joining us, our guest today is Anya Kiser. Anya, I'd like to get right into some of this history, if you wouldn't mind, that you were referring to, some of this personal history, the challenges, because it is quite a story you have to tell. You were born in Ukraine. Why don't you take it from there?
Sure. So I am a Ukrainian. I was born in Ukraine, and around age 3, I was placed into orphanage due to negligence of the parents and the unlivable conditions of the grandmother. And I was placed there with my sister, who was a couple of years later moved really, really far away. So I ended up growing up without her. And I, over time, I kind of forgot about her because I was still like 3-4 years old when they took her. And I ended up living at the orphanage until I was 11 years old.
Was this in Kiev, by the way?
This was in Berdansk. Okay, Berdansk is a central area of Ukraine. It's known as the vacation spot. That's where lots of Ukrainians go because that's where the Black Sea is.
Uh-huh.
So I grew up in what you would consider a city orphanage. However, the way it was, we never really got to leave the walls of the orphanage, maybe a handful of times that I can remember, and that's only for like Easter to go to church and such. But for the most part, we stayed at the inside the orphanage, and we had the playgrounds, and you know, you had your school, and your living situation is all in the same area. And so I stayed there up until I was adopted by an American couple, an older American couple,
And you were how old at that point?
I was 11, so I got, so we left Ukraine in December, and I turned 12 in March. So 3 months later, I turned 12.
So you lived in the orphanage for about 8 years then?
Yes.
8 or 9 years?
8 or 9. Yes,
closer
pretty
to
much.
Nine.
So it was the only thing I really remember, because I can't remember anything before 3 years old. So the orphanage was the home.
Uh-huh.
That's how I kind of grew up. But while growing up at the orphanage, you also get to see other kids who come in, and some get adopted, and you watch them leave. And then it's a constant, people come and look at the kids. And that's how I saw it. They came and looked at the kids,
yeah,
like
right.
as if they're shopping.
Kind of like
they're
shopping.
Mm-hmm. But they were coming to get the kids. They already like had it planned and stuff. So it wasn't shopping
uh-huh.
or anything like that. But I got to see that. And like every time I saw a child leave, I was like, I wonder if I'm going to be next. Like, I wonder if I'm going to get adopted. Like, or what would it be like to go abroad? Because most of the families I came to adopt were from other countries. There was one from Italy. Lots of them were from America. But it wasn't until my friend got adopted with her two other sisters that I really felt the impact of a loss. Because like, you know, she's one of my closest friends and she's leaving me, and it was just really sad. But you know, before she left, she's like, I'm going to find you a family. I will not forget. I promise. And
was,
so
was
on.
She your age?
Yep. She was in my grade. And then, so she left obviously. And then it was a couple of years. And at that time I figured she forgot, you know, like,
You hadn't been in communication
no,
with her?
No.
I see.
Because, you know, it's one of those, at the orphanage, we have one phone that I could remember. It was in our director's office, and it's expensive to make calls,
uh-huh.
you know. But a couple of years went by, and I get called into the director's office and saying, hey, like, we have somebody for you to meet, and so on. It ended up being my parents who adopted me, and then they found me through that friend that got adopted before me.
Uh-huh.
So she used her resources, her family, to find my family. And so I thought it was really, I thought she forgot about me,
uh-huh.
honestly. But no, she was
she
just
hadn't.
Doing her thing, begging her mom and dad to find me a family, which they did.
What was her name? What is her name?
Her name is Sophia.
Uh-huh.
Sophia Frederick. And she's just a year younger than me, but we're same year, like 93, but you know, she's just a couple of months younger. But she was one of my closer friends. And then I have another best friend as well, Dasha, and she got adopted much later. She got adopted at like 14, 15 years old, which is almost unheard of to be adopted at that age, because that is the line where you pretty much have to leave the orphanage around the age 15, 16, because you're no longer eligible to be in the orphanage, and you got to find your way
uh-huh.
on your own. So I was really ecstatic to hear she got adopted and she came to America. I was able to connect with her because she also lived like a couple hours from where my hometown was, and it was just amazing. I got to watch her swear in, become a citizen, and just now we're just best friends, and I see her a couple of times a month, and I'm a godmother to her baby, so that's really amazing.
Very nice. What did you say her name is?
Dasha.
Dasha?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that reminds me of this next song that you've selected. Speaking of Dasha and Sophia, with a little help from my friends?
Yes.
Tell us how that fits. I suppose it's fairly clear how it fits.
It is, but there's a saying that I have heard multiple times, and that is, alone I can go fast, but with friends I can go far, because they're there to carry you. So
uh-huh.
I think it's really important to remember that.
Well, you've picked a song that is right off our playlist. Let's hear it. With a Little Help from My Friends by the Beatles.
What would you think if I sang out a tune? Would you stand up and walk out on me?
That was With a Little Help from My Friends by the Beatles. Anya, you have told us about orphanages in Ukraine, or at least the city orphanage where you were. You've talked to us about adoption. And I gather, by the way, that adoption is something that you are in favor of.
I am definitely in favor of that, yes, 100%.
We're a little short on time, but for the benefit of our listeners, I might add, and you can elaborate to whatever extent you think appropriate, but Anya came to the United States, graduated from high school, did study in a couple of more different places around the country, and maybe you can fill in any gaps you think you should, but you spent time in Kansas, you spent time at ECU, you spent time in Korea.
Also Florida,
spent some time in Florida,
yes. Uh-huh.
And then I should add, too, that we're also talking to a Navy veteran.
Yes.
4 years in the Navy?
Uh-huh. LSD-41 with the island was the ship I was stationed on, Virginia Beach, and it was quite an experience.
Uh-huh.
A memorable experience I won't forget, but thanks to the military, it allowed me to have the lifestyle where I got to travel to Korea and study business there, and then I also got to go to school in Kansas and also East Carolina University. And now I'm working on my MBA program as well, thanks to the military. So
Very good.
Lots of benefits from that.
And you live in Rocky Mount?
I live in Rocky Mount near my parents. I wanted to be nearby because, you know, being around family is really important.
Sure.
But yes.
The name of the firm that you work at is what?
Tuscarora Company.
Tuscarora Company.
They're
okay,
a small wealth management firm, and they have given me the opportunity to learn new skills, and I'm very grateful for that.
Well, Anya, tell you what, let's wrap up by having you tell us something about this third song and maybe tying it in to whatever extent you can or want to the customer service theme we started with. And I know you also have a special interest in a particular holiday-related service.
I do, and it's very important to me, and I really wanted to share it with all the listeners. It's and you've probably heard about it before, but it's the Operation Christmas Child Foundation that sends Christmas shoeboxes all over the world. And I was one of those recipients at the orphanage. One of the memories is seeing this room filled almost to the ceiling with the boxes, because, you know, we have several hundreds of orphans. And just that memory of receiving the box and opening it was just amazing. It was simple things like a notebook or a pen. What seems insignificant here in America, where it's a given, it was so rare for us in Ukraine to have something of our own. And it was such a blessing. And of course, we got to see letters and pictures of the families that sent it to us. And let me just say, as the recipient of the box, how much it means to me and how much I know is going to mean to all the other orphans that are going to be receiving this, because otherwise they don't get anything throughout the year. And so this is a very special thing that you can do to make their year just a little brighter. And
I might say before you go on that that is really good to know, really helpful to hear from an actual recipient, to hear your words about that, because I know I've been around Operation Christmas Child efforts, packing boxes and so forth in the past, and you really just don't have a good idea sitting there in the church basement or wherever it is putting these together that it really does make a difference, but you're telling us it does.
It's most, for most orphans, it's the highlight of the year is getting that, because they don't get anything else throughout the year. So I think it's really, it encourages them and it gives them something to look forward to and something to brighten their whole year pretty much. And that's how it was for me.
I interrupted. You go ahead.
I was going to say the song that we're about to play,
called Red Sea Road.
Red Sea Road, yes. And it just talks about how God will part the sea for you. And it really applies to me, because as I grew up in an orphanage, I had a couple of families come look at me, but the road was just blocked. Things weren't working out. Families couldn't adopt me just because of all the difficulties. And when I thought I was alone, when I thought nobody was looking out for me, God was there. He was leading the way. And then he led my parents and he parted the sea. He parted the way for them to be able to get to me quite easily and make the process so smooth that we just knew that this was God's plan for my life. And with that in mind, knowing where I came from, knowing the difficulties that I've went through, I hope y'all can understand how important it is to just smile for someone, because you just don't know what they're going through. Even if you're going through a bad day, just remember that one smile can turn around their day, and it might affect you as well. And if you keep smiling, you just never know what kind of impact you might create in this world. So that's my little piece of advice, is keep on smiling even when you don't feel like it.
You've brought it back very nicely to where we started in your perspective on waiting on customers at restaurant tables. That's terrific. And the song you've selected, boy, what a powerful song. The lyrics and the melody together, just
that
really,
just the heart.
Yeah, for sure. Well, Anya, it's been a real privilege talking to you. Thank you for sharing your story with us.
Thank you for having me. I'm glad I could be here, and I'm glad I could share my story with you and all your listeners. So thank you for taking the time to listen to this.
I might note, by the way, that you did very nicely tossing in that y'all at one point.
Oh, I do that without even thinking about it. Y'all, it tends to be my favorite word to use since I learned English. And, you know, I didn't know English when I first came, so it took me a couple of years to learn it and be where I am now. So it took a lot of studying, but y'all, it tends to be my favorite English for the whole, out of all the words. That's it, y'all.
You've got it down.
Yes.
Well, thank you again, Anya.
Thank you.
Let's hear the song, Red Sea Road by Ellie Holcomb.
We buried dreams, laid them deep into the earth behind us, said,